Moving on. For our main story tonight, we thought we'd look at the border wall, one of the more upsetting things to emerge from 2016, tied, of course, with the reboot of the Gilmore Girls. And I know I'm a little bit late with this, but just a few notes. One, who the fuck was Paul? Two, not enough Paris. Three, seriously, who the fuck was Paul? Four, when did both of these women forget how to hold mugs? Five, I'm sorry, Emily says bullshit and tits now? Not in my Stars Hollow. And finally, who the absolute fuck was Paul? Hashtag Team Logan for life. That aside, you no doubt remember that Trump's border wall was the key promise of his first campaign. He talked about it constantly, even managing to inadvertently point out key flaws in the idea, like this.
There's no ladder going over that. If they ever get up there, they're in trouble, because there's no way to get down. Maybe a rope.
Yeah, maybe a rope. That was Trump recognizing in real time that his signature plan could be completely undone by thick string. And if that clip is familiar at all to you, it might be because that we played it in our first piece on the wall 4 years ago when I was approximately 50 years younger. And in that show, we discussed how the wall seemed, in addition to being transparently racist, like it was going to be both expensive and pointless. Well, I don't know if you've noticed, but Trump is actually president now and has spent the last 3.5 years putting his plan into action. In fact, just before the pandemic, he was reassuring attendees at one of his rallies that things were going great.
We'll soon be building many, many miles a week, but we're up to over 125, I guess 127 or 28 miles of the super duper wall. Super duper.
I'm sorry, the super duper wall? That sounds less like a description of border fencing and more like the name of an off-brand playset recalled because it collapsed on a bunch of small children. Listen to me, do not buy the super duper wall unless you want to wind up with a pile of cracked fiberglass and a flattened toddler. But clearly, the wall is by no means super duper. And while we predicted the whole thing would be a shambles, the extent to which that's been true, even we didn't see coming. Take what happened just this Thursday.
Steve Bannon and three others are accused of defrauding hundreds of thousands of people by personally profiting off a scheme to raise money to help build President Trump's border wall.
Yeah. Steve Bannon, the president's former chief strategist, was arrested, which is one of those things that you knew would eventually happen, but are pleasantly surprised that it happened so soon, like Jennifer Lawrence's Oscar win or Roger Ailes' death. And the story behind that arrest is absolutely fascinating, and I promise that we'll get into it later in this piece. But we thought that tonight, especially ahead of the RNC next week, it'd be a good time to give you an update on the status of Trump's border wall, because before he took office, he wanted it to define him as a president, and that has very much happened, but in none of the ways that he intended. So let's try and break down a few things. What he's built, what damage it's done, and crucially, who's been doing some of the building. And let's start with what exactly he has built. Because from the start, Trump insisted that he wanted a concrete wall, something that many Border Patrol agents had advised him against because it would block their view of what was going on behind it. Yet Trump was still so insistent on it that less than a year into his term, this happened.
President Trump said he wanted a big, fat, beautiful wall. These are his 30 by 30 foot options.
One of these eight contestants could soon stretch across the border.
There's a chance that one of them gets selected, eight of them get selected, or a mix of their characteristics gets selected for construction.
Yeah, Trump essentially organized a wall pageant. And look, if you're going to hold a weird contest in the middle of the desert, at least make it Saudi Arabia's actual beauty pageant for camels, a real annual event where the hottest camels are evaluated on the fullness of their lips, how gracefully they walk, and the size of their humps. And you might be thinking, wow, it's pretty problematic to objectify camels like that. But the fact is, this contest is actually one of the biggest scholarship opportunities that they have. And do you really think now is the time to argue that we need fewer camels in STEM? Of course not. Get real. Be an ally. But it is true, eight prototypes were built so they could test them to figure out which would work best, and it didn't go well. A government report found every mock-up was deemed vulnerable to at least one breaching technique, with one having the potential to impact the structural integrity of the entire mock-up, which is ridiculous. We all know the only wall that should be in danger of collapsing is the super-duper wall. I'm serious, do not buy that wall. It will squish your child like a panini. So the design they ended up going with was a wall of slats or bollards topped by a metal anti-climbing plate. And Trump did not like that design, reportedly telling officials he thinks it's ugly. And I have to say, he's not actually wrong there. I don't mean to wall shame, but if I had a list of hot walls, that one wouldn't even crack the top 30. This stone wall, scorching hot. This wooden one, call me tomorrow, you big tease. This human wall, I think we all know how I feel about that. Collapse on my chest. You impenetrable barrier. Crush my ribcage, you load-bearing behemoth. But this border wall? No, thank you. That's a hard pass from both me and the president. Still, Trump insists that regardless of how this wall looks, the important thing is it works.
We actually built prototypes, and we have, I guess you could say, world-class mountain climbers. We got climbers. We had 20 mountain climbers. That's all they do. They love to climb mountains. They can have it. Me, I don't want to climb mountains, but they're very good. And some of them were champions, and we gave them different prototypes of walls, and this was the one that was hardest to climb.
Okay, hold on, because there's no need for Trump to say, I don't want to climb mountains. That was, and I cannot stress this enough, assumed. If I knew nothing else about Donald Trump, based solely on his appearance, I'd immediately make three assumptions. Bad knees, weird dick, doesn't want to climb mountains. He's giving me information I already have. And obviously, that claim is bullshit. Not just because nobody's been able to find those champion climbers, but also because of this.
President Trump has called these refurbished walls unclimbable. But this video posted just yesterday on social media shows two men scaling a replaced portion of the wall in California.
Yeah, of course. You don't even need a rope if the wall can basically function as a fireman's pole. So to recap what we've learned about walls so far, fuckable, definitely fuckable, and very much climbable. So that is what the wall looks like. The next question is, where exactly are we building it? Well, as we pointed out in our first piece, finding places where you can build the wall is a bit of a challenge. Under Presidents Clinton, Bush, and Obama, hundreds of miles of border barrier had already been constructed. A bunch of the rest of the border is already covered by natural barriers or is on private property. So what Trump did was start building in the places where it was easiest to do that, specifically where barriers were already in place. In fact, of the 275 miles of new wall that Trump has completed to date, only 5 miles are in locations where no barriers at all previously existed. It might be tempting to think, oh, well, then he hasn't really done very much, has he? But Trump's acting Secretary of Homeland Security, a man named Chad Wolf, pushes back on that claim hard.
And you put up what's behind us, that's not replacement wall. That is a new wall. That is a new physical infrastructure. I don't agree with the assertion that we're simply replacing wall.
Okay, first, let's deal with the sheer Chad Wolfiness of this man. If I lost all my memories and fell into a coma for 30 years, opened my eyes and saw him, the first words out of my mouth would be, you must be Chad Wolf. He looks like a model for a knockoff Top Gun costume that you find at Party City called Top Flight Fast Pilot Costume USA. He looks like his parents started with the name Chad Wolf and then just found a baby to match. But he is actually right there. The replacement wall is a completely new physical infrastructure. I'll show you. Here is the old barrier in a remote section of Arizona, and here is the new structure. Those are very different. Claiming that they're the same because they're technically barriers is like claiming that John Cena and I are the same because we're the exact same age and we're both named John. Sure, yeah, on paper, there are some similarities. But when you compare the two side by side, one is gigantic and the other looks like it might collapse if you press on it too hard. But crucially, these massive new barriers are causing significant problems, disrupting animals' migratory patterns and slicing up people's land. And the thing is, for what? If this is about stopping drugs or people from entering the country, it's worth remembering most of that happens through our ports of entry. And even the Department of Homeland Security's own Inspector General issued a scathing report just last month saying the administration did not use a sound methodology to identify and prioritize investments in the areas along the border that would best benefit from physical barriers. In other words, putting walls where we've been putting them just doesn't make sense. And if you want to see just how nonsensical, new sections are currently going up along the top of these jagged mountains in a national wildlife refuge, which is just utterly insane. And this is costing a lot of money. Mexico, obviously, is not paying for the wall. Instead, we are, and in the dumbest possible way. So far, Trump has garnered $15 billion of taxpayer money for the wall, but only $5 billion of that was provided by Congress. Trump declared a national emergency at the southern border so that he could tap into Pentagon accounts for the rest. That redirection of funds diverted money that had been set aside for things like replacing an overcrowded middle school on a Kentucky military base or repairing a daycare for service members' children, which reportedly suffered from sewage backups, flooding, mold, and pests. And when asked to justify those decisions, Senator Lindsey Graham had a pretty amazing rationale.
Let's just say for a moment that he took some money out of the military construction budget. I would say it's better for the middle school kids in Kentucky to have a secure border. We'll get them the school they need, but right now we got a national emergency on our hands.
Wow. Everything about that is bad. From the idea that Trump's national emergency declaration was justified, which it wasn't, to the idea that his vanity project is better for middle school kids than a new school, which it is not, to that tie, which looks like a candy cane that melted on his shirt. It looks like the tie that Santa Claus wears to elf funerals. It's the worst thing in that shot, which is really saying something, because that shot also includes Lindsey Graham. And that brings us to our final question, who is building this? Because the answers to that are actually a little surprising. Just look at one of the companies that was invited to take part in that America's Next Top Wall in the Desert competition, Fisher Sand and Gravel. The head of the company, Tommy Fisher, knows how to curry favor with Trump. Here he is on Laura Ingraham's show, giving him the hard sell.
If he allows us to play and our team of Fisher Industries to play, I guarantee you no different than Tom Brady. Once we get in, we never come out. And if we don't perform, the president can fire us. And that's how comfortable and confident I am is when people see what we really offer.
I love it. I'm not taking sides on which prototype is best, but this is why you're a good businessman.
I love it! I didn't think Laura Ingraham was capable of that level of delight, but it turns out her love language is white men begging for attention. Because that man is thirsty as fuck. Oh, win for your daddy, just like that Tom Brady you like. And if I don't, you can fire me. Fire me like you used to on TV. And that was by no means Fisher's only appearance on Fox. He went on the network 10 times to praise the president and sell his wall. And these appearances seem to have had an effect. Because while both DHS and the Army Corps of Engineers actually turned down Fisher's initial wall designs because they didn't meet operational requirements, Fisher's company was nevertheless added to a small list of pre-approved bidders thanks to personal pressure from the president, who, according to one of the senators from Fisher's home state, liked Fisher because he'd seen him on television. And of course he did. Trump's like a shut-in who sits at home all day and orders what he sees on Fox commercials, but instead of ordering Legends XL male enhancement pills, he picks companies to build a giant wall across the border. But just as with boner pills, you shouldn't just buy something because you saw it on TV. You might want to at least Google it first, because Fisher's company had a lot of obvious red flags.
Fisher has been hit with lawsuits, one from the federal government for sexual discrimination in New Mexico. It settled for $150,000. The company and the founder's son were both accused of tax fraud in 2009. The son pleaded guilty. The company paid more than $1 million in back taxes.
Wow. So they cheated to get ahead, got caught, and yet they're still around. Turns out they really are the Tom Brady of the construction industry. But wait, there's more. Because over the years, they've also racked up around 2,000 violation notices from city, county, state, and federal regulatory bodies, including 469 criminal charges for violations in Phoenix, where the company ran an asphalt plant. Charges only reduced to civil penalties after Fisher agreed to permanently close it. But wait, I'm still not done. Local government officials have rejected their bids on contracts after considering, among other things, the fact that the former head of their family of companies, Fisher Industries, was convicted for child pornography. And sexual harassment, tax fraud, federal violations, and child pornography is not a great list for a company vying to receive government money. It's not even a great list for the Ozark Season 4 writers' room. Guys, that's too much. Not even Jason Bateman can make those crimes likable. And yet, Fisher was incredibly savvy about how to appeal to Trump, not just with his constant TV appearances, but also by hooking up with We Build the Wall. That is the nonprofit organization that led to Steve Bannon's arrest on Thursday. It was founded by a veteran named Brian Colfage, and it took money from individual donors with a promise that it would build new sections of wall on private land. It even had a fundraising wall-a-thon featuring a star turn from a man calling himself Foreman Mike.
We Build the Wall Construction. They are real. We need your help. We need to get donations in. We want to start. You can buy a bollard panel. Put your name on it for eternity because you're not going to last forever. $5,000. And if you can't do that, get yourself a brick. It lasts forever as well with your name, your family, your girlfriend, whatever you want to put on it. You need to donate today.
Okay. There's a lot to digest there, because despite what you may think, Foreman Mike is not a promo for a new WWE character whose signature move is the chaotic sales pitch. In fact, he isn't even the foreman on the project, just as We Build the Wall Construction is not a real construction company. He's just some guy they use to fundraise so he can grunt about personalized bricks, which I do admit are a great idea, because we all know the best way to deter someone who's crossing the border is for them to see the message, to the one and only Kirsten, may our love be as strong as this wall. And as ridiculous as that may seem, We Build the Wall raised $25 million. And yet, according to this week's indictment, quite a bit of that money wound up getting redirected back to Bannon and Colfage, who, along with others, worked together to misappropriate hundreds of thousands of dollars for their own personal benefits, with Bannon allegedly using money for personal uses and expenses, and Colfage allegedly spending funds on a luxury SUV, a golf cart, jewelry, and payments toward a boat. And look, Bannon and Colfage deny those charges, but it definitely paints this moment from that wall-a-thon in a very different light.
Welcome back. This is Stephen K. Bannon. We're off the coast of Saint-Tropez in southern France in the Mediterranean. We're on the million-dollar yacht of Brian Colfage. And Brian Colfage, he took all that money from Build the Wall. No, we're actually in Sunland Park, New Mexico.
I get it. Joking about stealing people's money is funny, because you know what they say? All great jokes have an element of truth in them. Now, Trump was anxious this week to distance himself from We Build the Wall, saying, I know nothing about the project, which is a little hard to believe, because here's Colfage with Don Jr. at an event where he described We Build the Wall as private enterprise at its finest, and here's Trump ally Kris Kobach on the group's own YouTube page being pretty unequivocal about where the president stood.
I was speaking with the president, and we were talking about a variety of issues, and the topic came up. I mentioned that I was working with We Build the Wall, and he said, well, you tell the people you are working with that this project has my blessing. And he went further, and he said, I want the media to know that this project has my blessing. He was really making a point that he was behind this.
Yeah, of course he was. I'm just surprised that Kobach didn't continue. This president wanted you to know he's completely behind this war scam. Until it fails, then you'll not be able to reach him and he won't have heard of you. That's just how this guy works. And look, to be fair, some of that $25 million they raised did go to construction. Specifically, they say they gave around $10 million of it to Tommy Fisher's company. Most of it to build that private wall in New Mexico that you saw a guy named Mike banging with a hammer. And that wall does appear to feature some personalized bricks, like this one that Colfage excitedly put on Instagram, which says, thick Latinas will not be deported, which is just fucking disgusting. The group also helped fund another Fisher wall built directly along the Rio Grande, which Fisher referred to as the Lamborghini of walls, claiming that it'll stand for 150 years, you mark my words. Although it seems to be conking out around 149 years ahead of schedule.
A ProPublica and Texas Tribune investigation found erosion beneath the foundation of a stretch of wall in Texas. That stretch was just built in January of this year by Fisher Sand and Gravel.
I'm just doing this with one hand, not even exerting myself.
Okay, so it turns out it really is the Lamborghini of walls, in that as soon as you get near it, the owner yells, hey, please don't touch that, it'll lose value and you could break it. And while I have to tell you, Fisher's attorney has told reporters that erosion is a normal part of new construction and that if there are issues that come up, we'll address it. It seems there are issues fucking coming up because experts have said it was concerning to see the level of erosion around the fence and that segments of the structure could topple into the river if not fixed. So to recap, Fisher Sand and Gravel is a company with a checkered past that partnered with a shady nonprofit whose backers are now under indictment for skimming money for their own uses in order to have a foreman who's not the actual foreman help build a wall that looks like it may either collapse or get pushed over. And if you know anything about this administration, it will not surprise you to learn that Fisher has now wound up with over $2 billion in border building contracts. They're one of the biggest contractors the government has hired for this project. And the thing is, should Trump be re-elected, all of this is only going to accelerate. In fact, his administration seems to be stepping up its efforts, attempting to take private land by filing more eminent domain lawsuits during the pandemic than at any other time in his presidency. And they're also using a provision tucked into the Real ID Act of 2005, giving the administration the power to waive all legal requirements necessary to construct the wall. And that means it's not bound by environmental or cultural heritage protection laws, which has enabled them to plow through Native American communities with devastating effects.
Construction crews in southern Arizona conducted controlled blasts earlier this year along Monument Hill.
Fire in a hole.
The same day of the detonations in February, the Tohono O'odham tribe's chairman sat before Congress.
It's hard to see the blasting that you showed on the video today. That area is home to our ancestors. And by blasting and doing what we saw today has totally disturbed, totally forever damaged our people.
That's horrible. As that man told Congress, for us, this is no different than DHS building a 30-foot wall along Arlington Cemetery or through the grounds of the National Cathedral. And I would like to think that that's something Trump knows would be wrong, but who knows, given that he had people tear gassed so he could stand outside a church holding a Bible with an expression like it just fucked his wife. And the devastation caused by this wall was completely predictable. I know that because we literally predicted it. And believe me, this is the last thing I wanted to say I told you so on. I'd much rather have said that about the fact that I knew Pete and Ariana weren't going to make it, or that a crockpot would be the killer on This Is Us, or the fact that I knew the Babadook was gay as soon as I saw him. Come on, guys. The hat. But even I didn't see some of this coming. From the pointlessness of a beauty contest in the desert, all the way through a sketchy charity selling personalized bricks. All of this was stupider than even I thought was possible. Because the fact is, this wall is not a functional barrier. If it's anything, it is a fucking monument to Trump, which actually makes more sense. Because we all know that he's completely obsessed with his legacy. Trump reportedly even asked South Dakota's governor how he could be added to Mount Rushmore. And while that is clearly not going to happen, for one thing, it's impossible to carve stone into whatever fucking shape his hair is, he also doesn't need it, because this is his monument. And there's perhaps nothing more emblematic of his presidency than this wall. It's destructive, pointless, ineffective, racist, weak, and something that the damages of which we're going to have to be dealing with for a very long time. That's our show. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next week. Good night.